Hi everyone, we're here at DevOps 2014 and I'm here with Chet and Romain. Chet.
Yeah, it's all the same.
Yeah, it's all the same. You don't even know who's who. We're here to talk about Android 5, that you know
yes.
what it is.
Yes.
Right. L stands for
Lollipop.
Awesome. And people are actually, as we speak, getting their updates over the air. So what are they actually getting? I hear things like material design.
That's pretty much it. Those are the first three elements, and then there's a couple after that, including material design, and then also the implementation of material design.
There are a few more features.
Are there?
Yeah.
Okay. That's certainly the ones that I worried about. So basically everything that the team that I'm on, which is the UI Toolkit team, worked on for the release was all about material design. Because the UX team's vision for material design was so grandiose and large, basically we needed to work the entire release to figure out how to implement that thing.
So you worked really hard so developers don't have to.
That's another way of putting it, sure.
No, so what are developers getting, really, with material design? So there are things like, you know, coloring, there are things like, obviously, animations, and all of that is baked in the platform at this point.
Right, right. So I think one of the things to come out of this, like if you go to these talks and you sort of read the articles, you're like, well, so what's this huge new swath of APIs that I need to use to implement material design in my app? And the answer is actually not that much. A lot of it just comes for free. So when you opt into the material theme, or if you're using the support library, you opt into the app compat theme, and then you're running on the Lollipop release, you're just going to get a bunch of stuff for free, which is the colorizing of the asset, so you're going to look like the standard widget should look on the platform. You're going to get animations in a lot of areas, icon animations. You're going to get shadows and elevation on standard widgets. So all of that stuff is for free. Then you can choose to opt into more material design capabilities like custom animations or activity transitions if you want to. But you don't have to do all of that stuff. It's sort of a sliding scale of how far do you want to go.
Okay. So that's obviously a big piece, material design. And users will see it. Developers need to be to understand what it is
yep.
that people will certainly expect to see.
Developers should definitely go read the guidelines because there's a lot to learn about. What's expected in terms of
So that was a conversation we had previously. It was, you know, is this something for just designers or should developers really read this? Just like,
yeah, it's
you know,
for developers, but designers should understand it as well.
And vocabulary is probably something important, so everybody's on the same page for that. Beyond material design, there must be a few other things. So notifications is one of the first things that users see. How does that surface in the API to developers?
Well, there's the new feature of having the notifications on the lock screen. So the users can choose what they want to expose on their lock screen because there's obviously a privacy concern. So applications can tell the system, you know, if the notification should be public, private, or secret. And then the user can decide if they want to make private notifications public or, you know, if they want to keep everything private.
Right.
So there's a lot around that. And yeah.
There's new APIs around colorizing your assets, so further branding of your application by coloring your notification icons. Sort of minor tweaks on top of what notifications already do.
Right, but for the most part, we're sticking. And any yep. use of the existing notification API will just
yep.
transfer.
That just works.
Yeah, everything that used to work still works. It looks better.
It looks better. That sounds pretty good. Concurrent documents. So one of the things people will see is that when they look at all their applications, every Chrome page is rendered as a separate document. So is that something that's available to developers as well?
Yeah, there's a new API. Applications can decide what is a document. And they have a lot of control over like when do they start a new document, how many documents do they want to keep in that list. And you know, for certain applications like Docs or Chrome, it makes a lot of sense. It's not going to make as much sense for other things like a media player, like a music player.
Right.
But it's up to the developers.
So one thing I saw in the release notes is the ability to have now a Chromium-based web view, which was one of the new things in KitKat. Mm-hmm. To have some sort of a modern web view with a number of new features. It's now being unbundled in a sense that it's there, but it's being updated outside of the main releases.
Yeah, so from the Play Store.
From the Play Store directly.
Right. So yeah, now the web view has the ability to be updated from the Play Store, so you can actually get more recent updates to web view outside of the standard platform releases at whatever time schedule they're at.
Which means whenever Chromium has this new release with support for, I don't know, WebGL or what have you, you can get it fairly quickly.
Well, and more importantly for bug fixes, for instance.
Oh, and that, of course.
Right. Yeah, I don't know what the specific plans are, like how frequently they would release it. The announcement was more around the plumbing and the capability to actually do the unbundled releases through
yes.
the Play Store for now.
Great. So any other APIs I'll get to runtime implementation?
Many APIs.
No, but once, I heard 5,000. It scared me a little bit. But we certainly don't have time to cover the 4,900 other ones. Any ones that you want to cover?
Let's see. Yeah, I mean, I can talk about APIs that I like personally. Ability to render PDFs, for instance, I think it can be very useful to a lot of applications. Obviously, not all of them. I also like the unification of all the media session APIs to be able to control music playback. Now there's a unified way of creating a playback UI in notifications, because now every media player has its own way of doing it. It can be a little confusing for the users, but now there's a common style, and since applications can brand the notifications, it will still look, like your media application. It's just easier for everybody.
So something else you're probably interested in is updates to OpenGL support. Mm-hmm. So what's new there? Is that just a new rev of
Android
OpenGL?
Android 5 is getting OpenGL ES 3.1, which brings a lot of very interesting features to graphics programmers and game developers. And also there's the introduction of something called the Android Extension Pack. So it basically gathers 20 existing OpenGL extensions and packages as a single one. So developers are guaranteed that all of these extensions will exist on all Android 5 devices. Okay. It's easier to manage them that way.
So all of that, by the way, is now powered by a new runtime. So Art is now the new and only runtime, and so there's no going back to Delvik,
there's
right?
No going back.
Over their dead body, I think they would probably say. So Art is a better runtime, and it's the only one there. It allows ahead of time compilation. It allows better, much faster and smaller pause time GC. So allocation of objects as well as collection objects is much faster. It also has the ability to defragment the heap by actually being a moving collector. So when your activity goes in the background, then that might be an appropriate time for it to actually gather the objects together, sort of create larger spaces in the heap, which was not possible under Delvik before.
So does that actually help you reach like those 60 frames per second at all? I mean,
because the more garbage you allocate, the more objects you allocate over time, then the garbage collector is going to come in and say, well, I need more memory. I can't find memory immediately, so I'm going to have to collect dead references to actually create the room to allocate more objects. And that took more and more time. The more fragmented your heap would get, the messier things got. So then you'd see pause times. If you just run Logcat, then you would see pause times of easily 10 to 20 milliseconds when it would do a full stop the world GC. And now those pause times are down to like 2 or 3 milliseconds at a time, which means it brings it below that magical barrier of 16 milliseconds. 16 milliseconds is the amount of time that you have to do everything to put the pixels onto the screen in order to maintain 60 frames a second, say for animations or other rendering stuff. So if we can get the pause time down to such a point where it's less significant or not huger than a single frame, just in and of itself, then we've got a much better chance of maintaining a smooth frame rate.
So if people are interested in the actual implementations of the GC, I would recommend they watch the Google I/O sessions that go into very much details
on
this.
As well as the Android Developers Backstage podcast. We had a two-parter because I was so into the runtime that we talked to Anwar for much longer than we were supposed to.
I listened to both parts, actually. Okay. So it was interesting enough for me to go until the end of the second part. So I do encourage people to listen to that one as well. So let's see, Project Volta, battery usage. Is that just an internal thing? So we gather statistics and we learn from it, then you guys can do stuff, or is it something exposed to developers as well?
It's similar to what we did before with Project Butter and Project Svelte. So it was an internal project, gathering a lot of statistics to understand what was going on in the system, obviously fixing the problems as they were identified, and then making available the tools that were built for internal use to all developers. So there's something called the Battery Historian. It's on github.com/google. It's a tool that was used by the Android team to find all those issues.
It's actually similar to a lot of the tools that we've seen on Android. Some of them look, a bit homegrown, and it's because they were, right? So the GPU profiler stuff, a lot of the, especially the on-device tools, as well as some of the DDMS tools, you actually wrote because you needed them to jank the platform in one way or another, right? Like, I personally would benefit from having a tool that showed me this information, so you write the tool, and then there's no reason not to push the tool out there for other people to benefit from as well.
Okay. Anything else you want to mention on maybe, I don't know, your favorite feature? It's like, I know it's like choosing...
Android 5 is a huge It's a huge release, and I think everybody should just go take a look at it. The SDK, you can run the emulator, the system images for Nexus devices are available. Look at the release notes. I mean, there's something for everybody.
Right, and we didn't talk about the devices, but there is certainly some new shiny devices to look at, a phone, a tablet, and certainly that is a good way to first experience as a user, and probably as a developer, they're really cool and powerful devices. Anything else?
Animations, lots of new animations. That's always a good thing, right?
That's all you care about.
Yeah. Well, it's sure. Yeah. Okay.
Great. Right. Well, I guess that's all the time we have for it. Thanks, guys.
Thanks.
See you soon. Bye, everyone.